Hey everybody, John Redman. We're back in my shop and been working on E-flite Albatros, kind of dolling it up and doing some weathering to make it look like it's been sitting on the front, out in the cold, out in the weather, ready to take off for its next sortie. Yesterday we went through a number of things, but as I tend to sometimes get ahead of myself, I didn't go over some of the things you need to do this, and I apologize for that. We're going to take care of that right now. First off, we did talk about the dull coat flat lacquer, which is great for electric airplanes because there's no fuel, it dries super quick, and that's what we're going to dull the whole airplane down with. But when it comes time to dirtying the airplane up, I use some light pastels, as you can see here, and normally you live off browns and blacks, maybe a little whites or yellows and such. So you might be wondering, how do I go from a pastel like this into a dust that I can put on my model? Well, I have some old JR servo cases, and I know a lot of you guys are flying Spectrum servos. They come in cool cases, and it's great. You can just get them, and you put it in here, and you've always got it. Seal them up for the next time. Then I take a Dremel with a fine grit drum sander, and note the way it turns. It's turning this way, so I'm going to take the pastel on this side, and it's just going to turn it to dust, very low speed. And you can do both fine grit as well as coarse grit, whatever you'd like. This just kind of fills up my little bucket, and then I've got it for this project, that next project. And if you're looking at all those greens and blues in there, I'll tell you, I've been throwing those away for a while. I just normally use the browns, the blacks, and the yellows. So as you can see, we've gone ahead and put some more of our brown in there and got that covered. We've got plenty of black, so that just kind of shows you exactly how we go from the pastel to the dust to help dirty the airplane out. Now, I was working a little bit yesterday to bring get more stuff done, and I've kind of completed the top hood or the battery hatch here. As you can see, the whole system. Now, let's talk a little bit about what I did. First off, I'm using Tester's Model Master paints, and I use silver, flat black, and then I have rust and leather. We will talk about in a short bit. But as we sit down for the flat black, in the world of scale modeling, honestly, black is not the right color. It should have a tinge of red in it, maybe a slight tinge of orange mixed into it to kind of dull off the intensity of the black. That's the guys that are doing the Scale Masters world, the Top Gun world, and truly trying to get the true color. You can, of course, go there as well. And my great friend Dave Platt has an incredible series of DVDs explaining exactly how to achieve the right colors for oil staining, grease staining, etc. I'm looking at this as just an everyday ARF. We're having a great time. We just want to add a little bit of, I guess you could say, pop to the airplane to bring it to life. So we're just trying to do it a little easier and simpler. So I just use straight flat black. And so here's one of my keys. One, how do you get all the little, what appear to be oil splatters on the engine, the intake manifolds and stuff like that? Well, believe it or not, it is not done with a brush. It's done with a piece of foam rubber. So I took a piece of foam from my bedding here, cut a little piece off, and you can trim these to smaller pieces and such. And what I do is I just kind of go ahead and dab it inside. And hit my paper towel to get the majority of the paint off. And then I come back, and what we're going to do is we are going to, look at here, great test piece just to show you. Kind of come, and you can see how we get kind of oil splatters. And this is how I did those all around. You can cut and vary the shape of your foam, etc. And hit just on a corner to get a little bit. Whatever you'd like to do. And that's how we did the oil splatters. So, like I said, simple piece of foam rubber to do that. And there's no real right or wrong way. And as you can see, I've got oil splatters down on the main, I guess, cowling or hood of the aircraft. As the way these engines worked is oil was sprayed right up here onto the rockers. And as they moved up and down, you know, during engine operation, oil just sprayed everywhere. It was very common for the pilots to carry a couple different pairs of goggles, as the goggles would get just totally coated with oil. They'd have to remove them and change them. Pretty messy situation. Next, on the exhaust manifold, the exhaust manifolds, as they were originally built, were built out of steel in kind of a silverish color. But as they ran and operated, they would, of course, turn brown, they would rust, they would oxidize. So how do we sit down and kind of, I guess you could say, highlight some of that? Well, that's done with our silver. And in this case, we take a brush and we get our silver paint here. And I put it on the paper towel. And then, believe it or not, just with the touch of my finger, I just dab in there. And I just kind of rub. And the goal here is to sit down, and there's very minimal paint on your finger. And what you're doing is you're hitting some of the highlight parts of the part, the plastic part of the paint, the roughness, and it brings it to life. And as you can see, just kind of adds a little highlight and such to make it look more realistic and help it out. I did the same thing on the guns. And for those of you who may not be aware, these four screws in the bottom here can remove the guns, helping you to dirty up behind, etc. Once that's done, and I had my touch-ups and my highlights done, now it was time to come back and weather out the main airplane with just hazes of dirts. And that's using my brown and green, and I use a big brush. And all you do is you get some of that and you just continually streak the airplane, just as you see I'm doing here. I don't have anything on it, it's already been done. But you kind of work that, and you will find after a while, you come back with your 4-aught steel wool, find this in any hardware store, and you just rub. And that kind of helps smooth the paint out. It helps smooth the covering a little bit more. And you go back and forth till you get the desired effect. There's no right or wrong way here, guys. It's real simple. It's not hard. And it just tries to bring something to life. Once that's done, a shot of the flat lacquer, hit it with our heat gun to dry it off, and then once again, brush it out with the steel wool. And I think you'll be very, very happy with the results. So we're going to go ahead and show you how we did that. I'm going to clean my paintbrush here real quick. I keep a small can of thinner for these things. You can buy these cans, believe it or not, at Home Depot all the time. Real cheap. I got my girl over here. She's kind of getting up, moving around. She's decided that I guess I have a handle on it, so she's going to turn her back to us and let us kind of work on the weathering here. So we're going to start with the wing panels, bottom of the wings. Now, I have already gone ahead and done all the rib stitching on these. So now it's time to dirty them up. And we're not looking to get excessively dirty, but we just definitely want to give it that look that it's been out there in the weather and doing its stuff. So I'm kind of tapping the brush down here a little bit. And notice how I'm streaking with the airflow. And as you do this, you'll almost sit down and think you don't have enough on here at times. And you think, oh, there's just not enough. It doesn't look dirty enough. And there's probably more on there than you think. A little bit of black. And then I followed up with some steel wool. And you can start to see this, the faint haze that exists over the cross being white and black. Really hard to see on the Lozenge. But starting to bring it to life. Now remember we talked about the wheels and how they throw a lot of muck up, and that was right here. I'm just really trying to work it in, and what I'm doing here is working the dirt into that flat clear that we've already sprayed. I'm just trying to get a little bit more, and you can see how we are able to bring some life on our rib stitching. That kind of starts to highlight and come out. It may be tough to pull up on video, but it's there, but it's very slight. Once we're done there, we're happy. We're going to go ahead. Move my glasses so I don't get flat lacquer all over those. The cool stuff about this is when I get done, I get on my counter and I just a real quick wipe with some lacquer thinner. Don't do this on your coffee table or your dining room table, guys. The wife will get upset. Here on this granite down in the shop, it works real nice. And if you've had a rough day at work, or maybe with the kids or whatever, let's just say, smelling a little bit of the lacquer may kind of help give you a little bit of a relaxing moment for a minute. You didn't hear that from me. Now I've got it on the low setting, and you'll see the lacquer start to dull out real quick here. And at the low setting, it won't cause any difference in shrinking of the covering. Now, as we've done this and we're all dry, you may see little parts of the steel wool in the finish, and that's not a problem because you come back with it one more time, and this will take any little specks of steel wool that might have been captured in the clear coat. They come right off, right out. You end up with a very smooth, clean job. And let's see if you can kind of tell the difference between the two. This one, you can see some of the faint streaks. I have started a little bit on this. Let's compare it right over here to this part. You can see just ever so slightly, a slight different haze over the covering. Not a lot, and the key is to be minimal. You don't want to go over-exaggerated. The great stuff about this, if while you're putting this on and you get it too dark, you get it too nasty, or let's just say you get a really bad streak, what is going to happen here? If you happen to get something, you go, oh my God, I've ruined everything. A little bit of Windex and a paper towel. This is what's so cool about this system. And it's gone. So, as I said, if you make a mistake, it's not a problem. You can always fix it. Make sure it's dry. And now we're going to go ahead and weather the bottom of this one. Okay, we've done the bottom. We're going to go ahead and do the top of the top wing. That way with the white, you'll definitely be able to see how it shades and highlights. Other things you're going to find is it's going to highlight around the spars and over some of the ribs along with our stitching. It's really going to bring a pretty awesome effect. So with our brush, get some brown on here. Because, you know, a little dirty there, flying off grass fields and in the mud and the muck and the rain. And right now you may be saying, well, it doesn't look like there's much there, but when we steel wool, it is when it really comes to life. I try and make sure I go over, you may be able to see some of the rib stitching coming to life, catching the dust. Now, I'm going to come back. Don't be afraid to push to where you can kind of pick up some of the highlights of the ribs and the spar, the structure detail underneath. Here you can see it before we hit it with the clear. Now we'll hit it with a clear. Come back with our heat gun, because as we know, I'm very impatient. And now one final hit with a steel wool. And now you can see how that wing looks once it's all weathered. What we're going to do is we're going to go ahead, I'm going to bolt these wings back on. I've already got the other wing panels done and the front of the fuselage, and we can really see how the front of the airplane is starting to come together. We'll be right back. Okay, so we've gone ahead and got the wings back on, and here you can kind of take a look at the top, and you can see some of the rib stitching and the dirtiness, just a light haze of dust and dirt over the airplane. It's not overly obtrusive. It's just a light haze, and overall, gives a very weathered and realistic effect to the aircraft, and definitely takes it from that R form to that of something you'd be very proud to show up at any field with at any time. Next, what we're going to do is I'm going to take you through, and we're just going to dust the back of the fuselage ever so slightly, because it's in and such, and get it done in the tail. And we're going to go over a couple of the things we did on the tail to help enhance the model there, and then we'll talk about the prop. Okay, kind of started to work on the fuses, you can see, and you're going to note something. You can, of course, see the dirt streaks going down, but you see a lot of just black and brown kind of dabbed right up in here on this side of the fuselage. Now, here's my reasoning for this. This is where the individual would climb into the aircraft, and these guys, there's no heaters, and it's cold at 10 and 12,000 feet, so they had these really huge, very, very thick wool and leather coats and big, long trench coats. So as they would be going in, that definitely would have drug on the side of the airplane as they're rolling up in and they're holding on, getting in the cockpit and such. And I'm sure those trench coats weren't cleaned very often, so they probably carried a lot of just grime and dirt as well. So that's why this side, the other side's not like that, because they would always climb in from the left side. And such. That's just, if you're wondering why, after 20 years of maintaining fighters in the Air Force, I can't tell you, except that's just the way we do it. You always go in from the left. Don't know why, you just do. So that's kind of why that's all gross and a little disgusting. And here I've got some browns and some blacks, and I'm pretty much ready to come in and hit this, the whole tail and whole back of fuselage, with some clear. And we're going to do that, and then we're going to steel wool it. We'll be right back. Okay, as you noted, the real unique hinging system for the rudder and elevator. This is actually very accurate to the way it was done on the real aircraft and such. So we tried to replicate that as much as we could. The kind of odd-looking thing from the ARF side of it is you had these monster pieces of brass on the tail. So with some flat white and some flat black from testers and a brush, all I did was go over and touch those up and paint them to where they, because they would have been painted to match whatever the tail looked like. Real simple and easy, and now you can see they kind of blend in, and from 5 feet you won't even see them. So we have just a little bit here of the black here in the cross, the white here at the bottom for our hinges, those brass pieces, and that's done top and bottom. And definitely helps take the model to a new look back there. Time now to dust it up and get it just a little bit dirty. Now, the key is the tails routinely stayed pretty clean on top. They got a little mucky on the bottom from the tail skid ripping through the ground and stuff and the grass. So we're just going to go ahead and a real light coating. The key here is just to highlight some of the structure is more of the goal, I believe. And I'll be honest, I'm mainly a World War II geek. So I'm just kind of guessing, and by looking at some of the pictures, I am in no way an expert back here, but I think we just want a slight little bit of highlight. Nothing crazy. You can see how I'm getting some on my brush and then above, and I tap the brush and that drops the droplets of dust onto the airplane. Once that's there, I'm going to go ahead and next, a little bit on the rudder here. Now, the next step is I'm pretty confident they would have kept these hinges lubed up quite well. So, smaller brush. And make sure you do the black areas too, because believe it or not, it does change the hue, especially out in the sunlight. And a light dusting with the steel wool over those. Definitely makes it look like the oil or the grease they would have used would have been streaked back. Everything you do on the airplane needs to be done in terms of airflow in the air. So that's why I'm not going up and down on the vertical. Okay. Kind of got the back end done, got it shot with some flat clear, wiped it again with the steel wool, standard stuff, so it's like we did on the wings. It's looking good. Now it's time to throw some oil on the windscreen. Got my little piece of foam. And the key here is less is going to be more, so I've really blotted it off. And I'm coming in. And this may take a couple applications. I want to go real slow and easy. I don't want real big oil drops because it would have been fine, a fine mist kind of like by the time it got back here. A little too heavy in a couple of spots. But nonetheless, now you can see we've got a little bit of oil splattered on there. This is the prop that's called out for in the manual. and it's an APC, and it doesn't have that gray look, as we can tell. So how did we come up with this? First off, using this type of paintbrush. It's a camel hair, number 6, just a basic, but you can see the point I want to show is it's got kind of a poofy, ballish look to it at the end. Kind of like for a female or a lady's makeup brush and such. So using this, I then painted the prop very carefully, flowing it out very nicely off the airplane, of course, with tester's leather color was the first color. And once it was all painted, of course, I got out my trusty heat gun, went to work, got it dried, took a couple of minutes, then cleaned my brush. Then I mixed up in a cup. I used a popsicle stick. I dipped it into a bottle of tester's rust color and put it in the cup and followed that with thinner until it was almost a watery mixture and such. So then I sat down, dipped this brush in there, and then I went and kind of blotted it off on a paper towel and just stroked ever so lightly on each side. And I did that front and back. Once that was done, I then took a popsicle stick of black, flat black, and put it back in that same mixture of rust and thinner and darkened it up a couple times with a couple drops and then a little bit more thinner, making it a very, very, very dark brown. Using the same brush, put it in there, blot it out on the paper towel, and a couple of very light strokes. Hit that with my heat gun, wiped it with the steel wool, and it kind of gives you the wood type effect of a laminated wood prop, and definitely helps bring the front end to life. Now, in my process with my dirty hands, I can see I've kind of got some ick on the spinner here. The spinner, for the most part, would have stayed pretty clean on these models. It's out in the front. Okay, next we're going to talk about what we did to the wheels. Now, the wheels on the real one were actually bicycle spoke tires type design. Of course, they're much better than a bicycle tire in a day, but the end result is you can see the rib stitching I've got done out here on the outside. And that's because they fabric covered both the inside and the outside of the wheels, and they had to stitch that so it wouldn't get torn off. The reason they covered the wheels inside and out was for aerodynamic reasons. When they flew with just the spoke tires, a lot of drag, so they cleaned those up. And so that's why we have the rib stitching all the way around the outsides. Now in here, you know that they would have kept these axles lubed heavy for all the gook and stuff they would have been driving through over time in grease. So what we did is a Q-tip with water around, just to wet the area around the axle opening right here. And then I took a very small brush with my black chalk and I sat down and I'd hit all around and just kind of worked it out in a fashion as it would have been spun out from centrifugal force. And once that's done, then I took another Q-tip, a dry Q-tip, and took it and just rolled it out a little bit to help kind of show the grease that splattered and continues to splatter and spit over time. Very simple. Once that's done, of course, heat gun it to make sure you evaporate all the water, and then dusting it a little bit, as you can see, with the black chalk to dirty it up, and then shoot it with your coat of clear. And your wheels look very similar to what they used to look like on the real ones. Okay, so pretty much we're about done. We've finished up. We've got everything weathered. It's got a nice coat of flat clear on it. It's going to stay like this. You can pick it up and move it. At any time from now on out, if you feel it's getting a little gritty or you maybe see a fingerprint or two, just get out your 4-0 steel wool and just wipe over it, and you should be good to go. Of course, Windex and a paper towel can clean it, and it'll come back looking like this because it's all been sealed by that flat clear. But we've shown you how to go through and kind of do the oil splattering on the windshield, intake manifolds and such, and really kind of bring the entire front end and the engine to life and that hood cowl. We showed you how to do some rivets up there on that cowl. I got my girl over here. She had a little itch as she's in her supervisory role. Showed you how to use the glue with a syringe doing all of the rib stitching. to help bring some life on the wings and the horizontal stab. And of course, the pencil lining for the wood fuselage, how the panels would have been done. And overall, I think I'm quite pleased with how the airplane has come out, and I think you'll be pleased too. Anybody can do this. It's very easy. It's not hard, and keep in mind, there is no wrong way. So we really hope you've enjoyed this tutorial on weathering your E-flite Albatros D.Va, or of course, any other warbird out there where you can take these tricks and take your model to the next level. Remember, if you ever have any questions, you can always find me at editors@horizonrc.com. We'll see you at the flying field.